Hello friends, I am Shubhangi Rohatgi and your biology guide for today. And today we will study chapter 5, Morphology of Flowering Plants for class 11th NCERT. Now, do you know the meaning of morphology? This term stands for study of external features, study of external structures. Now, when we talk about the study of morphology, I have come across many a times to the students saying that they don't like the study of morphology or they find it boring and not interesting. So, I want to tell you about two things, that this study of external structure is very important. It forms the basis for higher studies in evolution and physiology and even in ecological adaptations. So, we cannot do away with it. We have to study the structure, then only we can proceed to the other higher branches of biology. And as far as boredom is concerned, I can assure you one thing, that in today's session, I'll try my level best to drive the boredom out of the class and see to it that you don't have to mug up the things. When you try to rote memorize the things, then the chapters become boring and not interesting. So, let us try to understand the logic behind the study of morphology. In this chapter, we will learn the standard definitions and standard technical terms. Now, again, these things are very important. When you try to classify successfully the living organisms, then you need to know the specific standard definitions and standard terms that are used for their description. We will also learn about the possible variations that are in different parts of the plants. These lead to the adaptations, as I told you earlier. Now, a plant has root, stem, leaves and flowers. So, in this chapter, we will study about all these structures one by one. Let us begin with the root system. Now, root. If a young student comes to you and asks you, how will you define a root? What will you say? How will you help that young fellow? You might be tempted to say that roots are the structures that grow underground. The underground parts of the plant make up the root. But is this definition always correct? What about potato, turmeric, ginger, onion? You have been studying or hearing since junior classes that these are not roots. These are some other structures. So, we cannot safely say that all the structures that are present below the ground are root. One safe definition can be that root is that part of the plant that arises from the radical of the embryo. Here you can see this is the plumule and this is the radical. The root arises from the radical of the embryo. Though it is not always the case, as we will see in the later course of the session, that some roots also arise from parts other than the radical. But yet, it is one correct definition that the part that arises from the radical can be said as root. There are many different types of roots. Actually, when I was uprooting some weeds in my garden earlier someday, I noticed that the roots were of different kind in different plants. For example, here in this plant, you can see that the root is fibrous. It is profusely branched. And we cannot see any main root. And I could not help but notice that this plant is a monocot plant. While on the other hand, there were some other plants where we could see that roots were completely different. Here there was one main primary root and many lateral branches arising from this root. And you can see that the plant is dicot. By the way, this is carrot grass. So, we have ample points to differentiate between two kinds of roots. One is the tap root. Here, this one that you just saw is the tap root. And the other one is the fibrous root. Let us recall the points once again. In the tap root, the primary root is persistent And primary root bears many lateral roots, as you can see them here. They are mostly present in the dicots, for example, carrot or carrot grass for that matter. On the other hand, if we talk about the fibrous roots, let us see them again. In the fibrous roots, the primary root is short-lived and many roots arise from the base of the stem. And this kind of root is mostly present in the monocots, for example, the grass. Now, functions of the root system. Again, you must be knowing that the roots are primarily concerned with the absorption of water and mineral from the soil. But are there other functions also? Yes, they help in providing proper anchorage to the plant. They hold the soil so that the plant can stay upright. Besides these, some roots are modified to store reserve food material for unfavorable conditions, and many roots synthesize the plant growth regulators. Now, what are the plant growth regulators? Plant growth regulators are the chemicals which play a very important role in regulating various growth related activities of the plants. These can be onset of dormancy or breaking the dormancy, abscission, seed set, fruit set, fruit fall, leaf fall, elongation of the shoot or elongation of the root tip. All the activities related to the growth are controlled by various plant growth regulators, and some of these regulators are synthesized by the roots. Now, we know that we have just said that a root needs to penetrate deep down into the soil so that it can absorb water and mineral from it. Now, in order to penetrate, what should the structure of the root tip be? The root tip should be slender, very fine, so that it can penetrate deep down, and also it must be soft so that it does not get broken when it hits something hard. And at the same time, it should be covered with a protective covering so that it is not damaged. That means the structure of the root tip is very typical. Let us see the structure. Here at the bottom, very bottom of the root tip, you can see a root cap. As I just told you, that this root cap is protective in nature. Its main function is to protect the root tip from the damage. Just above the root tip, you can see there is the region of meristematic activity. Now, in earlier classes, you have studied that meristematic tissue is the tissue which is concerned with production of new cells in the body of the plants. So, it leads to the growth. The growth can be in terms of gain of height or it can be in terms of gain of girth. Meristematic tissue continuously produces new cells in this very region. Now, what happens that the cells produced by meristem are very small and they have a conspicuous nucleus. They have dense cytoplasm and there are many such layers of meristematic tissue in this region, the zone of meristematic activities. Now, these cells do not get any chance to grow in size. The meristematic tissue here, it is just cutting off new cells continuously, and new cells are being formed very quickly. These cells are very small, so this is not going to elongate the root, but the root needs to elongate so that it can penetrate deep into the soil. For that very purpose, what happens? The older cells, here there will be the newer cells and these will be the older cells. These older cells, they start elongating. And as the cells become older, many more layers of the cells become elongated. This is the reason where actual elongation or gain of length takes place. This is the zone of elongation. So, this region of elongation that helps in the gain of length of the root tip. Now, once the cells have elongated, they start maturing. And by maturation, we mean differentiation. What is differentiation? Differentiation means acquisition of proper structure and function. So, when the cells have elongated properly, they start differentiating and acquire proper structure and function. Like the epidermal cells, they will produce root hairs. These root hairs will be used for absorption of water and minerals, and the xylem and phloem, that is the vascular connections, will also be formed. So, this is the zone of maturation, where the older cells get mature, and this is how the root tip is formed. These are the three regions of root tip. I repeat again, the region of meristematic activity, region of elongation and region of maturation. We just studied that besides absorbing water and minerals from the soil, root perform many other functions, and in some plants they are specifically modified to perform other functions. Let us see what are the root modifications for. Roots are modified for the purpose of storage of food. They may also provide support and respiration. Yes, some roots are also modified to perform respiration. We will see. First, let us discuss the roots which are modified for the storage of food. This is the figure which is given in your NCERT books. You can see the turnip, carrot and sweet potato. All of them are roots. These two are the tap roots and this is adventitious root. In this picture also you can see the roots of the dahlia and adventitious roots of the sweet potato. These are the roots that store food. Have you noticed that these are the parts of the plant that we consume in these plants? And please notice this, that we always consume that part of the plant in which the plant stores its food, for that matter, so that we get the energy that the plant had stored for itself. So, many roots are modified to store food. Now, there are some roots which are adventitious roots. What are adventitious roots? In the very first slide, I said that most of the roots arise from the radical of the plant embryo. This is the radical and it gives rise to the root. But in some cases, the roots also arise from parts other than radical. Like they may arise from the base of the stem. If this is a stem and this is the layer of soil and normal root growing here, there may be chances that sometimes some roots arise from other parts, the lower parts of the stem. These structures, they grow towards the soil and function as root. These roots are known as the adventitious roots. These are present in many plants. When they are present at the base of the stem, they are known as the stilt roots. And when they are present higher up in the plants, they are known as prop roots. So, here I have picture showing the stilt roots in maize and sugarcane. You can see here the from the base of the stem, the stilt roots are growing and they are growing towards the soil. And this is a very classical picture of banyan tree showing the prop roots. Now, the question arises, why? Why do we say that these are roots? They are arising from the stem. They are not arising from underground parts. How can we say that they are stems and they are roots and not stems? Can you think of one reason? Yes, the reason is that they are all growing downwards towards the soil. Roots are always positively geotropic, but the shoots are negatively geotropic. They move away from the ground or the soil. So, this makes us say that these structures, which are though growing from the stem, but they are roots because they are positively geotropic and the function is to provide extra support for the plant. Now, As I said earlier, that some roots are also modified for performing respiration. This is the picture that is given in your NCERT book of pneumatophores. What are pneumatophores? Actually, mangroves are those plants that grow in coastal saline or brackish waters, and in these waters there and regions and habitats there the soil concentration is very high and the soil is waterlogged, so the plant faces lack of oxygen. In such a condition, a normal root can die. So in these plants, pneumatophores are developed and they are the breathing roots. Let us see what happens. This is the actual picture of pneumatophores of Rhizophora, and you can see the pneumatophores coming out of waterlogged soil to breathe. How do they breathe? They have lenticels at their tops. Lenticels are very small openings on their tips, and they help in breathing. Now, this was all for the roots. We studied that roots arise from the radicle. We studied the difference between fibrous root and the tap root. Then we studied the functions of the root, the regions of the root tip, and some of the modifications of the root. Now, we will move over to the stem. How will you define a stem? If a root is a structure that originates from the radicle, then the stem is the structure which originates from the plumule. Again, referring to the earlier diagram, there were two structures. One was radicle, the other is plumule. And plumule gives rise to the stem. Now, stems also have nodes and internodes. Here in this specimen, you can see these are the nodes, and the portion between the two successive nodes is known as internodes. The nodes are somewhat swollen parts, and the leaves, branches, everything arises from the nodes. Now, here in this specimen only, I would like to point to a very important structure, and that is the axil. The leaf axil. This is the leaf axil. The portion between the stem and the petiole of the leaf. This is known as the axil. A leaf axil always bears an axillary bud, and these buds arise to form new branches. We will return to the axil and axillary buds later when we talk about modifications of stems and leaves. But for the time being, please remember that the portion between the petiole and the stem is known as the axil. Now, we know the functions of stem. Some of them at least we know that yes, they spread out the branches. Why? When the branches are fully exposed to sun and water, they will get ambient conditions, the leaves will get ambient conditions to perform photosynthesis. And stems are also concerned with conduction of water, minerals and food. Water and minerals are conducted from roots to upwards and taken to the leaves for carrying out photosynthesis, and then the prepared food is taken to the all of the parts of the plant, and the prepared food is taken to the rest of the plant parts, and it may be stored in sink organs also. So the conduction of the water, minerals and food is two-way conduction. Water and minerals are taken from the roots upwards to the leaves, and food is taken downwards to roots for storage or to some other organs of the plant. Besides these, the stems also provide support. Some stems are modified to provide protection, and some are modified to provide vegetative propagation. How? We will see further in later slides. This brings us to the modifications of the stem. Stems are variously modified to perform many different functions. They are modified as phylloclades, cladodes, thorns, stem tendrils and bulbils, and we will now study the function of some of them. First modification that we are going to talk about is the modification for storage of food. Now, we had earlier talked about the potato. Potato, we have studied that it is a modified stem which grows underground the soil, in the soil, and stores food. Let us see why do we say that potato is a stem. Here you can see the eyes of the potato. We all know that these eyes may bear some new shoots. Actually, these eyes are the axillary buds, and these are the nodes of this stem. The stems which store the food, they also act as organs for perination in unfavorable conditions. So, here is this picture with labelings. These eyes which I just showed you are the axillary buds, and at the terminals you can see that some of them are already budding out in the form of shoots. Then other stem modification is ginger. Here you can see the presence of scale leaves, and colocasia. It is also a modified stem to store the food. Here, as I told you earlier, that these modified stems act as organs of perination to tide over unfavorable conditions. So, you can see the new shoots arising from these organs. Besides providing as organs for perination or storage of food, some of the stems are also modified to provide support in the form of tendrils. So, climbers are, we know that, very weak plants with very weak stems, and they need something to cling to so that they can climb up. That's why they are known as climbers. So, some stems are modified in the form of tendrils to provide support. They cling to any object that comes in their way. Here it a proper label diagram showing the stem tendril. Now, what I want to focus here is the position of this stem tendril. Please see that this tendril is arising from the axil. Axil, I just had talked about axil in the earlier slide, that the position between the petiole and the stem, axil. So, stem tendrils, which are modifications of stems, always arise from the axillary bud. Similarly, some stems are also modified to provide protection. Here in this specimen, you can see that thorns are present. And why do we say that these thorns are stem modification? Because they are present in the axil of the leaf. And thorns are present to provide protection against the grazing animals, the browsing animals, or the children plucking the flowers. So, this is a picture showing stem thorns, the thorns which are formed from the modified stem. They are also present in bougainvillea. Now, we know about cactus, where the stems are modified to perform photosynthesis. Why it happens? Because here the leaves have been modified into spines to reduce the rate of transpiration. So, the function of photosynthesis has been taken over by the stem. It has turned green and it carries out photosynthesis. Now, many a times stems also serve the purpose of vegetative propagation. This is a picture of runner of grass, but actually I have got a very beautiful specimen showing the runner. Please have a look at the length of this runner, and this is not the complete one. I could get just this much of the specimen. Now, let us see what happens. What actually is a runner? Here you can see, let us think that this is the first plant. Okay? And here the roots were arising from it. A lateral shoot arose from it and developed underneath the ground. Here at this point, it produced new roots and a new plant arose from this point. Again, another lateral shoot developed, and at some point it produced roots and shoots. And in this manner, along the length of the runner, you can see so many plants have arisen. You can just imagine how quickly a portion of land will be captured by this growing grass through vegetative propagation. Such runners are also present in mint plants, and such lateral stems are also present in some aquatic plants where they are known as offsets. So, stems are the organs for vegetative propagation also. With this, we have finished our talk on the stems. We studied that the stems bear nodes and internodes, they have axils, and axillary buds mature into branches, then stems are modified to perform various different functions. Now we come over to another fascinating organ, the leaf. As I said earlier, the leaves develop at the nodes of the stem. But how will you actually define a leaf? We cannot say that a leaf always carries out photosynthesis or is green in color, because as we will see later, there are some modifications where these functions and these features have been dropped. So, there must be one character that defines the leaf, and that character is the presence of axillary bud. Now, leaves originate from the shoot apical meristem, the meristem that is present at the apex of the shoot, and they are arranged in acropetal order. Acropetal means youngest at the apex. I will help you to break down this term. Learn it this way: A for acropetal, A for apex. So, youngest at the apex, this is the acropetal order. Here is this picture of leaf given in your NCERT books, but we will study from the specimen. So, let us see all the features that we have discussed so far. This is a specimen from the shoot tip of a plant. Which plant is it? Can you identify? Yes, it is very common peepal. Now, you can see here the leaf is arising from the stem. This is the axil, and from the axillary bud a new branch has come out. Again, a leaf arose at the node, and here in the axil of this leaf, this young leaf, you can see the axillary bud. Besides the axillary bud, which will grow into new branch, two stipules are also present. Unfortunately, here only we can see one stipule, otherwise there are two stipules which are present here. Now, the leaves, as I said, are arranged acropetally. Acropetally means the younger leaf is at the apex, while the older leaf it has the base. So, this is the acropetal order. Also, talking about the structure of the leaf, you can see that this expanded portion, this portion is known as the lamina of the leaf, and the stalk which joins the leaf to the stem is known as the petiole. We have already talked about the axillary bud and the stipule. Now, you can see that there are many veins running throughout this leaf. This is the main midrib, and many branches are emerging out of this midrib. What is the function of veins? Yes, they conduct water and minerals and photosynthesis in the leaf lamina, but they also provide rigidity to otherwise very soft and flowy lamina. They keep it extended so that the leaf can capture quite a lot of sunlight when it is available. This was about the structure of the leaves. Have you ever noticed that all leaves do not have same kind of venation? You must have seen these two kinds of leaves at least. Here in this leaf, you can see there is this midrib, is it visible? And the other veins which are running parallel to it. On the other hand, in this very leaf, you can see that there is a network of veins arising from the midrib. These are the two kinds of venation. In the picture also, you can see this is parallel venation, and this is net like venation, which is known as reticulate venation. So, this is reticulate venation, and this is parallel venation. Also, these venations Reticulate venation is mostly found in dicot plants, while parallel venation is found in monocot plants. So, just by looking at the type of leaf venation, you can tell whether a plant is monocot or dicot. Remember my earlier slides where I showed that fibrous roots are borne by the monocot plants. That was told by the structure of a leaf venation, and tap roots are present on the dicot plants. Now, we come over to the next topic, that is the type of leaf. Up till now, we have seen all these leaves that I have shown you, they were the simple leaves. This is the picture again of a simple leaf. Now, think what will happen. You can see that there are serrations, the margin is toothed. Okay? There are small incisions on these margins. Let us draw a picture of such a simple leaf. Suppose this is the stem, this is the axillary bud and the petiole, and here the midvein, the midrib, and this is a leaf with serrated or toothed margin. Now, what will happen if these incisions which are present, they go deep down like this. Then again we will say this is one leaf and these are the lobes. It may also happen that these incisions may be present quite deeply. So, we can get a structure like this. And we will say that the leaf is deeply lobed. What will happen in the next stage? You can all imagine, and I will draw it for you. Again, the leaf axil, the midrib, and now these cuts, these incisions have further moved deep within. They have reached the midrib. So, what will happen? We will get structures like this on the either side of the midrib, because the incisions have reached the midrib. Here you can see them. So, now this makes it a compound leaf. Such a leaf is known as compound leaf. Now, when you look at such a leaf, such a compound leaf, a question arises in my mind. How can you tell me that this is a part of compound leaf? Actually, these little leaf-like structures are now known as leaflets. And the midrib, this is known as the rachis. The question that arises is, just by looking at this very structure, this very leaflet, any leaflet for that matter, can you tell whether is it a leaflet part of a compound leaf or is it a simple leaf? The question arises. Can you answer this question? Can you tell me just by looking at this particular leaf whether this leaflet is actually a leaflet or a simple leaf? The answer lies in the axillary bud. We see that the axillary bud is present between the attachment of petiole to the stem. If the axillary bud is present here, then this whole structure is a compound leaf. We have seen that axillary buds are not present here. So, this makes them the leaflets. I have got a specimen for you. Now, you will have to tell me whether this specimen is of compound leaf or these leaves are simple leaves. I repeat my question, just tell me about this particular leaf, whether is it a leaflet or a compound leaf. How will you tell me, is it a simple leaf or compound leaf? We will again look for the axillary buds. Here you cannot see any axillary bud, can you? But you can see the axillary buds here, these brown structures I hope you are able to see it. So the axillary bud is here. This means this whole structure is one compound leaf, and these are the leaflets of this compound leaf. Let us move ahead. So we have studied that compound leaves are those in which the leaflets arise. But in this picture, you can see there are two types of compound leaves. One where the rachis or the midrib is visible, and the other where all the leaflets seem to be arising from one point at the petiole. These leaves are called as pinnately compound leaves, and these are the palmately compound leaves. So there are two types of compound leaves, pinnately compound leaves and palmately compound leaves. In the pinnately compound leaves, leaflets are present on the common rachis, that is the midrib. For example, as in neem. While in palmately compound leaf, the leaflets are attached at a common point on the petiole. For example, as in silk cotton. Now we come over to the next topic, and that is phyllotaxy. Phyllotaxy means the pattern of arrangement of leaves on a stem or a branch. There, have you ever noticed that leaves do not arise randomly on the stems? If you look closely, you will find there are definite patterns in which leaves are arranged. So, three most common patterns are alternate, opposite and whorled patterns. Alternate phyllotaxy is seen in China rose, opposite in guava and whorled in Alastonia. I have got this specimen for you, and can you tell me which plant shows which phyllotaxy? Let us name this specimen A and this B. Can you tell me which phyllotaxy is present where? Here you can see the leaves are arising just opposite to each other at the same node. So this is opposite phyllotaxy. And here you can see that leaflets are arising in a zigzag manner, not on the same node. One arises at one node and then the other arises at a later node. This phyllotaxy is alternate. Now, if in your exams you are asked to draw opposite, alternate or whorled phyllotaxy, will you be able to do that? Yes, but I will show you how you can do that in very small time. If you are asked to draw the phyllotaxy, please draw only the line diagrams and don't mess up with the leaves. If you just draw the location of the petiole, that will be sufficient. So this makes up for the opposite phyllotaxy, and with another diagram you can show the alternate phyllotaxy. And finally, talking about whorled, which seems to be most difficult to draw if you try to draw the leaves. So you can draw a node and many leaves arising on it. We'll use a different colored pen so that the petioles are visible. Here we have shown that many leaves are arising from one node, and such a phyllotaxy is known as the whorled one. Now, as we have studied that roots and stems are modified to perform various functions, so are the leaves. Leaves are also modified to perform many functions. So we will now study about the modifications of the leaf. This is the figure that is given in your NCERT book, and in this figure we can see the three different modifications of the leaves. Some leaves are modified to give support. We talked about climbers earlier. They are very weak plants, and they in these plants tendrils are developed, and these tendrils cling to any object that is nearby and use it to climb up. Now, how will you differentiate between a leaf tendril and a stem tendril? We had discussed this part earlier also. If this is the stem, this is the leaf, and the tendril is arising from here, this will be stem tendril. Why? We had discussed it earlier. Please try to recall that it is arising from the axillary bud, and axillary bud gives rise to the branch. So, this is a stem tendril. But on the other hand, let us see at another diagram. If we see that a tendril is arising directly from the node, then we will say that this is a leaf tendril, and it might bear an axillary bud in its axil. So, axillary bud, it is the identification mark of a leaf. Coming over to next modification, we had earlier also talked about cactus, where the leaves are modified into spines. Why? Because cactus grow in very dry and arid areas, where the plant tries to save every bit of water that can be saved. And so, to reduce the rates of transpiration, the leaves are modified into spines. And this is the structure of an onion. And here we can see that leaves have become fleshy. Why? Because they store food. Earlier also I told you that whatever part of plant we consume mostly stores the food. This was about the normal modifications, and in some plants the leaves are modified to perform very special function. Can you identify this plant? This is pitcher plant. It is an insectivorous plant, and the leaves are modified in the shape of a pitcher. What do they do? Whenever an insect sits on the pitcher plant, it is attracted and goes inside. Now this flap is turned off, covered, the pitcher gets closed, the insect cannot come out, and this leaf will now secrete digestive juices, and whole of the insect body will be digested. This is done by these plants to meet their nitrogen requirements. So, this was about the leaves. We studied what are leaves, how are they variously modified to perform different functions, and we also studied about different types of leaves, their phyllotaxy and their venation. The next topic that we are going to cover is the inflorescence. What is inflorescence? Just as phyllotaxy was arrangement of leaves on the stem or branch, inflorescence is the arrangement of flowers on the floral axis. There are many types of inflorescence, but for the sake of simplicity, we can divide them into two groups, racemose inflorescence and cymose inflorescence. Here in this picture, you can see the racemose inflorescence, where the main axis continues to grow, that is, it shows indeterminate growth, and the flowers arise laterally in acropetal fashion. I had earlier also told you acropetal means youngest at the base, but you do not have to mug these things up. I will show you a very easy way to understand and learn it. First of all, talking about the floral axis. Suppose this is the floral axis where the flowers are going to arise, and this structure is known as peduncle. And the stalks of these flowers, they are known as pedicel, peduncle and pedicel. What happens in a racemose inflorescence, this peduncle has unlimited growth. It keeps on growing without being terminated by a flower. Suppose it has grown this much in length, now a lateral shoot will arise and it will bear a flower. The peduncle will grow for some more time, another shoot will arise here. Then peduncle will grow here and the shoots will arise and bear the flowers laterally. This way many flowers will be born, and the floral stalk is yet free to grow more. Now what happens? The flower which grew earliest is the oldest one, and the flowers which are followed are the younger. In this way we get that the youngest flower comes to be at the apex, while the oldest flower comes to be at the base, and this is the acropetal fashion or acropetal order. Now if you remember this very definition of racemose inflorescence, you will never have to mug up that flowers are born in acropetal order in racemose inflorescence. I will repeat it for you. Here the peduncle is keeping on growing and lateral branches are arising and bearing flowers. So in this manner the oldest flower will be at the base and this will be followed by the younger flowers at the apex. So here the fifth flower, it is the youngest, and first flower is the oldest. This is the racemose inflorescence. Even in your exams, when you are asked to draw racemose inflorescence, please don't draw messy diagrams bearing flowers and all. This line diagram will sufficiently explain the meaning of racemose inflorescence. Just opposite to the racemose inflorescence is the cymose inflorescence. Racemose can be seen in snapdragon and brassica. You all must have seen mustard plant, sarso. The flowers on the sarso plant, brassica, are arranged in racemose manner. This is the peduncle and this is the pedicel, just to remind you. Just opposite to racemose is the cymose inflorescence. So, wherein racemose we said the peduncle showed indeterminate growth, here the peduncle must stop growing. How will it stop growing? By producing a flower at its very terminal. And how will the other flowers now be born? When the first flower grows at the terminus, a later shoot develops here at the base, and the second flower is grown here. Then third flower will be grown from the base of this plant, this flower, then another, and this way what happens? The oldest flower comes to at the top, oldest, while the youngest flower reaches the base. This kind of succession is known as Bessie petal succession. There can be other mechanism also. Here we saw that the flowers were being born on only one side. It can happen in another way also. Suppose this was the peduncle, it got terminated with a flower. So two lateral branches will arise from this very point and each of them will be terminated by a flower. Now these two will also be flowers at the lateral branches. In this manner, the oldest flower remains at the top and the youngest flowers come towards at the base. Instead of writing young and old every time, I can simply write the numbers in the order in which the flowers were born. So both these examples are of the cymose inflorescence. Let us rewind. This is a cymose inflorescence. This picture is given in your NCRT. The main floral axis is terminating in a flower here, and then shoots are arising below the main axis and again terminating in the flowers. So here the main axis has limited growth, that is the growth is determinate here, and because of this very feature the flowers are born in Bessie petal order, that is youngest at the base. As for acropetal, we try to remember it as A for acropetal, A for apex, here B for base and B for Bessie petal. So youngest flowers will be at the base in the Bessie petal succession. But again, if you remember how this happened, you will never have to mug things up. This was all about the inflorescence. Examples of cymose inflorescence are Dhatura and Bougainvillea. So in this session we'll stop here. We have covered the root, the stem, the leaf and some portions of inflorescence. In the next session we'll study the structure of flowers, the nomenclature of their parts, and we will learn to write the floral formulas and floral diagrams also, and then we will learn how to describe semi-technically three families, Fabaceae, Liliaceae and Solanaceae. So let us try to do some exercise questions. The first question is, what is meant by modification of root? What type of modification is found in banyan tree, turnip and mangrove trees? After following today's lecture, I am quite hopeful that you can answer this question. I will give you a small hint that roots which arise from any other part other than radical and or perform some functions other than absorption of water and mineral can be said to be modifications of root. You can elaborate on them, and then you can always tell that banyan trees have prop roots, turnips have roots for storage and mangrove trees have roots for breathing, the nematophores. Next question in your NCERT is, justify the following statement on the basis of external features. The statement is, underground parts of a stem are not always root. We had just discussed this thing, that everything that grows beneath the soil is not root, it can be another structure also. So while framing your answer, try to recall this point that underground stems like potato tuber have nodes, internodes and axillary buds, and these structures are not present on the roots. The next question that I would like you to do is, how is a pinnately compound leaf different from a palmately compound leaf? We already discussed that in pinnately compound leaf, what happens? Many leaflets arise on the midrib, all through the length of the midrib. But in palmately compound leaf, the structure is like a palm. That is, many leaflets are originating from one single point, and that point is the petiole. Here the midrib itself has already divided into many leaflets. So in palmately compound leaf, all the leaflets arise at the same point on petiole. The next question is, explain with suitable examples the different types of phyllotaxy. We had just discussed opposite, alternate and whorled phyllotaxy. When you write the answer, please try to draw these types of phyllotaxies and give proper examples. The last question is, define the term inflorescence. Explain the basis for different types of inflorescence in plants. Inflorescence was the last topic that we did, and we had already discussed that inflorescence is the modified shoot which bears a group of flowers in a specific pattern. And while you try to develop the answer, please you can use these points to differentiate between the inflorescence, that is the racemose and the cymose, that the main axis, the floral axis, whether it shows determinate or indeterminate growth, and whether the plants are the flowers are arranged in acropetal or basipetal arrangement. Now I would like to give some questions to you to think and reflect, and also write them in your copies. Differentiate between racemose and cymose inflorescence. I hope the discussion that we had on inflorescence will help you to write the differences. Try to write at least two differences and give examples also. Similarly, differentiate between fibrous root and adventitious root. Again, try to write two differences and try to give examples also. The next question is, describe the modifications of stem with suitable example. We had discussed a number of stem modifications. Give proper examples while framing the answers. The last question is, how do the various leaf modifications help the plant? Again, write proper functions of each of the modifications. While framing the answers for biology questions, please keep in mind that you have to try to write the answers in points. Write short and crisp points, and if possible, support your answers with Lyell diagrams. That's all for the today's class. Thank you, and in the next session, we'll continue with the later portions of this chapter. Thank you.